This man's generosity has transformed the lives of millions throughout the world and in Ireland. Yet very few people would recognise him or know what he has done.
Astonishing. I can't say I've ever encountered such an extraordinary individual.
Complex? He certainly always wanted to play fair, but he wanted to play tough.
Odd. A conversation with Chuck Feeney is unlike any other conversation you'll have with anyone on earth.
Paradoxical. When the history comes to be written, it will be shown that Chuck Feeney did have a significant impact on Ireland.
Inspiring. He inspired us to think big.
Spiritual.
Chuck Feeney, and you've probably heard this from a whole lot of other people, is a totally one-off.
Compassionate. He'll know more about you in 20 minutes than you'd ever know about him.
Oh, I think the man is a saint.
This is the remarkable story of a man who had it all, but realised it wasn't enough. Chuck Feeney has led an extraordinary life. He became one of the wealthiest men on the planet, but throughout his life has chosen to remain outside the glare of the media spotlight. For over 25 years, his contribution to Ireland, both economically and politically, has been monumental, yet until recently, it went undocumented. Now, in his late 70s, he's telling his story in the hope that others will be inspired as he was. It begins in the Depression era of 1930s America. Charles Francis Feeney was born in 1931 into a small Irish-American community in New Jersey. This was the time of the Great Depression, and both his parents worked hard to give their kids a good start in life.
I went to a school in an Irish-American neighborhood, and it was a Catholic school. We felt we were part of that community.
Chuck's mother, Madeline, had a strong sense of doing right by the less fortunate. She worked nights as a volunteer Red Cross nurse. And for her, there was no one quite like her only son.
But he could do things with a straight face, and he could get away with it because he was my Charles. As far as my mother was concerned, he could commit no sins.
She was a good woman, clearly, and she would just consider it as an obligation to help your neighbors.
When you live in a family like that, that she was very, very concerned about her neighbors, I think that rubs off on you, you know, you are concerned about people.
You had already been involved in a few money-making schemes. I mean, you had an eye to making a buck.
Yeah, the typical things that the kids do, mow the lawns, do odd jobs for neighbors. Particularly recall a friend of mine whose name was Moose Foley, and I partnered with him because he was the biggest guy in the class. When we'd go out to shovel snow, I'd be the front man. I'd go over and sign up the places we'd had to shovel, and then I'd whistle up for Moose, and he'd come over and start shoveling, and I'd start selling again.
Moose Foley did most of the shoveling. I know that because my father used to say to him, "You were a real conniver, you know. You're always thinking, you know."
After leaving school, he joined the Air Force and was stationed in Japan as a radio operator during the Korean War. One of the benefits of his military service, as he well knew, was the right to a free education afterwards.
Veterans administration offices have been set up in every state. And it's here the ex-soldier goes if he wants to continue his education under the GI Bill of Rights. You mean he can get any kind of education he wants? Now you're getting the idea.
Chuck Feeney, the kid from a blue-collar New Jersey town, aimed high. He applied and was accepted into the respected Ivy League University of Cornell, the first in his family ever to go to college. The grant from the GI Bill didn't leave Chuck much extra, and it wasn't long before he started looking around for money-making opportunities.
I saw this guy coming around selling sandwiches, and I saw the students flock down to buy a sandwich, and so I said, I can do that, it's not difficult, and so I became a self-made sandwich man.
It was at Cornell that he met a group of men who would later play vital roles in his business life. The most influential of all was a young New Yorker studying law.
I thought he was selling sandwiches with too much bread and too little peanut butter. He was clearly an entrepreneur. His Cornell experience was, I think, for him transformative. And he not only enjoyed the experience and the people, but tremendously enjoyed the friendships. And he always had this sense of gratitude, and therefore, as part of his overall view, that it's good to give back.
Following his graduation in hotel management, he traveled to France to continue his education, a decision which would change his life forever.
Life is playing the hands that you're dealt, and I wasn't quite sure what cards I would be dealt, but I was always thinking about ways of making a buck by working myself as opposed to working for somebody.
In 1956, there were 50 ships of the U.S. 6th Fleet in the Mediterranean alone. Each of the 30,000 servicemen was entitled to buy liquor tax-free. And Chuck was quick to spot a good business opportunity.
I was in a bar and I ran into an Englishman who was just starting up a business of selling liquor to the naval ships. And he sent me down to Athens. I got down there and they told me that the visit of the ships had been canceled. Using my innate intelligence, I spotted a couple of hookers and asked them, did they know when the ships were coming? And they knew exactly the day. I stayed on for the 2 weeks, and then I started my career selling liquor to the ships.
Chuck, the ex-GI, and his partner had found the perfect business. No setup capital and cash up front.
We were buying something for five, plus the transport cost, and selling it for almost 15. I looked at the market and said, well, geez, if it's good for the military, it must be good for the tourists. So we started doing the same thing, selling them gallon packages of liquor. I said, well, if you can sell liquor, why can't you sell perfume? And so we sort of expanded our range of products.
As the sales to the tourists continued, Chuck realized that there was a new market opening up with the military.
And they would get so many requests for automobiles, he said, well, we ought to get into the automobile business. And Germany was a natural because at that time there were about 250,000 military in Germany with dependents. And so that was why the business was started there in Frankfurt in the summer of 1964. You had an immediate sense that there was almost some genius with this fellow. Just his focus on life, focus on the business.
Definitely, what do they say, type A personality? For sure. Walked quickly, talked quickly, worked incessantly.
Things were looking up as the sale of cars, alcohol, and perfumes continued. But Chuck and his team were in for a shock. Back in New York, they brought in an old college friend to advise them on a tax issue.
We did reorganize the businesses, and we reorganized them so that the tax risk was eliminated. The bad news is that they weren't making money, but they didn't know it.
Well, when I arrived in New York, it was clearly a mess. Yeah, it couldn't be described any other way. There was no accounting systems. And it took not very long to conclude that the liabilities exceeded the assets by approximately $1,600,000.
We got involved in businesses too quickly. Before we knew it, we were subject to cutthroat competition. I mean, if you fail honestly, you don't go to jail. If you fail dishonestly, you do go to jail.
Cash flow was tremendous in that people paid very early for the cars. So everybody looked at this money in the bank as profit, as it were. There were no expense controls of any sort. People spent money as they saw fit, and it resulted in the enormous deficit. We would be very lucky if we just got it out of debt and closed it down and moved on to something else.
The business was in serious trouble, and the new team of Chuck Feeney, Alan Parker, Bob Miller, and Tony Pallaro had no choice but to pay their debts and move on. But an opportunity was just around the corner, which was soon to make them one of the most successful business partnerships in the world. The concept of airport duty-free shops was not new. In fact, the very first duty-free shop was opened in Shannon in 1946. But in the early 60s, international travel was still confined to the privileged few, and large profits from duty-free sales were unimagined. Concessions to run the shops were granted by each government to the highest bidder.
A friend of ours wrote to us to tell about a shop that was going to open up at the Honolulu International Airport, and there would be the concession to sell any kind of duty-free merchandise you want. We bid about $125,000, guaranteed over 5 years. I got no time at all. We were doing a giant amount of business.
Oh, yeah, Chuck was always the most optimistic, and because he was a visionary, he could see what was going to happen. I was just looking at the figures and adding them up. I could see them growing, but no, Chuck clearly was the visionary.
With the Olympic Games of 1964, the Japanese government was keen to present a more liberal image to the world. Japanese citizens were allowed to travel abroad in greater numbers, and the most popular destination was Honolulu in Hawaii.
Chuck's instincts are sensational, and his competitiveness and tenacity are amazing. He's also completely focused. So whenever there was an opportunity to make a change, big or small, to improve the business, Chuck would often see it.
As we explored the Japanese market, we realized that they were keen to buy bargains. And we would sell a bottle of Johnny Walker Black Label at that stage for about $7 a bottle. It cost them in Japan $35 a bottle, so it was a bargain.
And so you had this frenzy. The same was true of perfume, the same was true of cigarettes. They were buying for 10% of what they could buy it in Japan. And in many cases, you couldn't even find the product in Japan.
It was very obvious then that this is a business that had great potential. And I think that the one thing that should be indicated about Chuck is that he had the foresight. I mean, he had the vision.
The best descriptive word for that is lucky. Because, you know, if you want to pick an emerging market, pick one that people want, need, get value from, and all of the things that we did qualified.
One of the rules that the business adopted early on, and for which I was appointed the policeman, was quiet, actually anonymity. And at least in Chuck's case, was a desire to stay out of the limelight. The more you advertised your success and bragged about it, the more likely it is that you were going to attract both jealousy and competition.
With the incoming 747s, I mean, it just changed the business dramatically overnight. You know, the lid literally blew off.
Well, the 747 has flown millions of people this past year.
Some of the first years that I was there, I think we were doing like $10 million a year at the airport. And the downtown store, I mean, during its heyday, would do $1 million a day. I mean, it was mind-boggling.
You know, we were just trying to make a buck, and that seemed like a good way to make a buck.
It was an exciting time. I mean, every day was like getting up for the kickoff, because it would be always something very dramatic, very exciting about it. We drank a lot of champagne, we drank a lot of everything. but it is, you know, when you work hard, you worked hard, and when we played hard, we played hard as well.
What was the buzz for you at that stage? Was it the business or the making the money or both?
I guess it was the success of the business. Yeah, so we started with nothing and now look what we've got.
Well, the money began to grow pretty quickly, and I would say by the early 70s, the profits were rolling up very quickly. By that time, it was more than a single duty-free shop. They had bid elsewhere. And they were the largest duty-free retailer in the world. I think by the late 70s, they had 5,000 or 6,000 employees. The volume by that time was $3 billion a year or so. And because of the structure that had been put in place, virtually all of those profits were tax-free.
I grew up with my parents having these parties and having a grand old time. we were the house where people came and had barbecues and had parties, and people always came with their kids. It was always kids and adults parties.
I enjoyed what I did. I enjoyed particularly the people that I worked with, and I was always thinking that I don't need another $1 million.
But as the profits rolled in and the four partners reveled in their multi-million dollar lifestyles, Chuck began to realize the effects that great wealth could have, not only on him, but also on his family.
My dad was kicking us in the butt since we were 14. Get out the door, do this yourself, figure it out. He was pushing us to be active and sporty and tough.
I felt that they should have the opportunity to see how money is earned. And they knew that there's a difference between what you make and what you're given.
More than anything, he wanted us to have goals and passions. And he thought, well, how could they have this? They're born with everything already. You know, people have to fight and strive. So he made sure we did.
I remember having a conversation with Chuck and quoting to him, which I can only do approximately, the statement that the Reverend Gates made to John D. Rockefeller, in which he said to Rockefeller, your wealth is rolling up, and if you don't do something about it, it will crush you and crush your family. And Chuck kind of got that. He is uncomfortable with displays of wealth and lavishness. And I think that grew over time. I think there were times when he enjoyed entertaining people at some of the houses that the family then owned. So I think there were things about it that he enjoyed. But the growth of the disquietude eventually outweighed the pleasure at being able to entertain and bring people together.
There's a halfway mark where we were living a certain life. You know, my dad was fun at a party. Then I think things got a little bit more serious with the amount of money and also an awareness. When you travel and see how people suffer really, you know, it's not just an idea.
I think life is a learning process, and you read books, you read stories, you empathize with people. I have had always empathize with people who have it tough in life, and the world is full of people who don't get enough to eat. It was by 1980 I started thinking, where's all this leading? You know, what am I going to do with it? Like many of the wealthy people today, they have the money, but they wouldn't be able to spend it if they started to spend it.
It was the early 80s, and the decade of greed was well underway. While much of the world was consumed with making money, Chuck Feeney decided he was going to do something completely different. It was the start of a journey which was to change his life and the lives of many around him.
I think because of his upbringing, a blue-collar New Jersey guy, a guy in college had to sell sandwiches to get through school, is that when he started making these tremendous amounts of money, he was almost embarrassed by it.
He worked so hard to get there. And once he did, I think he found, I know he didn't like these fancy dinners, and he didn't want to go places that they were invited to, that was, you know, he was very low-key.
Chuck doesn't own a car, doesn't own a house, has one pair of shoes and a $15 watch.
I would be unhappy with myself if I was wasting money on anything, and that includes living. So I get what I want from life and move on.
He's happy going out to dinner, and if he can get a good bottle of wine, he's happy with that, and sometimes even a better bottle of wine. It's just that his personal style is not self-indulgent or lavish.
You know, I'm a guy who's said that I could be happy with a grilled cheese and tomato sandwich.
Because he'd always insisted on remaining anonymous, very few people had any idea just how much Feeney was worth, not even his family. By now, his fortune was estimated at around $1 billion. And although no one knew, he was secretly developing a radical plan to give everything away.
Well, I think it was clear throughout that there would be a moment when virtually all of the assets would be used for charitable purposes. Never perfectly clear what virtually all meant, because Chuck didn't want to impoverish his family, but it was clear, increasingly clear, that he didn't want very much for himself.
Did you not at any stage wonder yourself, am I going nuts? Am I doing the right thing here?
So I suppose you always question business decisions, and this was in effect a type of business decision.
I warned him, a good lawyer is supposed to warn clients about risks, and I said, you know, you can't change your mind on this. Once this is done, if the money is transferred, the assets are transferred, they're gone. And if you change your mind 3 days later, you can't get them back. And if you think you've made a mistake, you can't get them back. And if things go awry, you can't get them back. It's irrevocable. Are you sure you want to do this?
And there was no going back.
No going back once we decided.
I think he actually was impatient with that because he'd made up his mind and thought it was fine. He said, yeah, let's get on with it.
Chuck Feeney, the man who had worked his whole life to build a business empire, was about to change everything with the stroke of a pen. In November 1982, having made a relatively modest provision for his family, he signed over his entire fortune to his new foundation, the Atlantic Philanthropies.
I got a phone call one day from him and he said, I have a big announcement. And he said, I just wanted you to know that I've given everything away. And I said, you mean every penny? And he said, I've given it all away to a foundation. And I said, oh, well, that's good if that's what you want to do, you know?
I mean, I'm really proud of my dad. I think he's just really an extraordinary man. He's, you know, he's just such, who does this? Honestly, who does this?
I was surprised, I will admit, but I knew that he didn't do it without having given a lot of thought to it. And the Irish expression that he has, there's no pockets and shrouds. Well, I think he just came to that realization and said, okay, I'm going to change what I'm doing.
I guess down to a realization that it doesn't add anything to your life. As I say, it may make life a bit more comfortable for you, but I'm not uncomfortable today.
Chuck Feeney's philosophy of giving while living is central to everything he does. His belief that it's better to give money away now has changed the lives of millions, and his work isn't over yet. Feeney, an extremely shy man, recently made the difficult decision to sacrifice his anonymity and cooperate on a biography with Conor O'Cleary. He did it because he wants his message of giving while living to inspire others.
My sense is that he's getting to a stage in his life now where, as I think all of us do when we get a little bit older, you ask yourself, what has the meaning of your life been and what have you been able to contribute? I sense that the most important thing for him now is to spread the gospel of giving while living and to influence more people who have money to give it away and to give it away wisely.
We are what we call a spend down foundation, which means that we are going to, over the next 9 years or thereabouts, to spend down the assets of the foundation, which would be in excess of $3 billion.
In order to meet the deadline of spending our endowment out of existence by 2016, we have to give away $1 million every day of the year, 365 days a year.
There's logic in making things happen now, especially if now there are things out there that are necessary.
Nowadays, Chuck Feeney still travels to see the work that Atlantic Philanthropies supports in 7 countries around the world, in projects on aging, children and youth, population health, and reconciliation and human rights.
And I'm not here to tell anybody what they should do with their money. If you make your money, you do what you want with it. But I think there is an obligation, certainly, for the haves to reach out and to look at, see what they can do. any money that people give to any good cause, as long as it's well managed, is worthwhile. I just hope that that people will sort of try it. You'll like it.
Today, with the same relentless drive and attention to detail that made him one of the world's richest men, Chuck Feeney is now giving away the last of his billions.
I wouldn't put him happy in the sense of content. I would say he's happy with what he's been able to do and wishes it would be more. And he's probably just as restless and consumed with trying to make it better now as he was in 1962.
He wants to be in the center of things. He wants to be where the action is. And if he has to get on an airplane and fly to 5 different airports, he'll go.
My husband said to him one time, why don't you just have a conference call instead of, you know, spending a day and a half in the airport to get wherever.
I think my dad would wish he could live till he's 160, if not more, to keep involved. And he tells me how pissed he is that he's not going to be able to see how things turn out here or there. He wants to keep going.
He'll never retire. I doubt it. He couldn't. He can't.
I don't know. Maybe the Lord's word is the decider on that. The poor are always with us. You know, you'll never run out of people you can help.